Welcome to our video worship time. It's Friday afternoon as I'm recording this portion of our service, the end of what has been a somewhat challenging week, one that reminds me again just how important times to set those things aside and focus on our Lord really are. Even now as I'm recording, I'm encouraged. Sensing our unity in spirit and unity in purpose and mission. Our next gen minister, Bryce Cooper, is going to speak on that very topic, our one mission. Before Bryce brings his message, we'll hear a very special reading from God's Word and have opportunity to sing praise. Let's worship together as we are invited with these words from Psalm 96.
we sing alleluia, alleluia. We sing alleluia, we sing alleluia, we sing alleluia, alleluia. We sing alleluia, we sing alleluia, we sing alleluia. Let all things their Creator bless and worship.
И подошел Иисус и заговорил с ними: «Мне отдана вся власть на небе и на земле, а потому идите и обращайте все народы, крестя во имя Отца и Сына и Святого Духа, и учите их соблюдать все, что я заповедовал вам, и буду я с вами всегда до скончания века».
Jésus s'approcha et leur dit: «J'ai reçu tout pouvoir au ciel et sur la terre. Allez chez tous les peuples pour que les gens deviennent mes disciples. Baptisez-les au nom du Père, du Fils et de l'Esprit Saint. Apprenez-leur à obéir à tous les commandements que je vous ai donnés. Et moi, je suis avec vous tous les jours jusqu'à la fin du monde. »
Und Jesus trat zu ihnen, redete mit ihnen und sprach: Mir ist gegeben alle Gewalt im Himmel und auf Erden. Darum geht hin und macht zu Jüngern alle Völker. Taufet sie auf den Namen des Vaters und des Sohnes und des Heiligen Geistes. Und lehret sie halten alles, was ich euch befohlen habe. Und siehe, ich bin bei euch alle Tage bis an der Weltende.
Então Jesus aproximou-se deles e disse: Foi-me dada toda a autoridade nos céus e na terra. Portanto, vão e façam discípulos de todas as nações, batizando-os em nome do Pai, e do Filho, e do Espírito Santo, ensinando-os a obedecer tudo o que eu lhes ordenei, e eu estarei sempre com vocês, até o fim dos tempos.
E Jesus se acercou e lhes falou, dizendo: Toda potestad me es dada en el cielo y en la tierra. Por tanto, id y haced discípulos a todas las naciones, bautizándolos en el nombre del Padre y del Hijo y del Espíritu Santo, enseñándoles que guarden todas las cosas que os he mandado. Y he aquí, yo estoy con vosotros todos los días, hasta el fin del mundo. Amen.
Then Jesus came to them and said, All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always, to the very end of age.
I appeal to you, brothers and sisters, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that all of you agree with one another in what you say, and that there be no divisions among you, but that you be perfectly united in mind and thought. So last week, I read this appeal from Paul to us. And this week, I want to add the cry of the heart of our Savior to his Father in heaven, as it's reported in John 17, starting in verse 20. And when Jesus said this, he said, "I pray also for those who will believe in me through their message, that all of them may be one." Everybody in the family of God, that we would be one. Why? So that they may be brought to complete unity. That we would be unified around the truth and the mission of Jesus. So last week we talked about having one enemy. And I wanted to lay the groundwork of who exactly we are fighting against. Because we have to understand that we are not fighting a what, but a who. And the who is not some other group over there. The enemy is real. And he will do whatever he can to divide us. He'll also do whatever he can to distract us from our mission. So today, I want to talk about our one mission. But first, I want to ask us a quick question. What would happen if we stand unified as a church? Jesus said in the passage that I read from John 17, that the world will know God, that you sent me and have loved them. Even as you love me, I pray like Jesus prayed to his Father, that all the believers may be one, that they may be brought together in complete unity. So, in other words, instead of being divided and weak, if we stand united and strong, resisting the schemes, the attacks, the strategies of the evil one, the enemy, we could help usher in God's will on earth as it is in heaven. Paul prayed that we would be united. Jesus prayed that we would be one. What if we could be the generation that is the answer to their prayers? Help us, God, unite. Help us stand together around the truth and the message of Jesus. The question is, how do we do it? How do we become one? What would it take for us to unite around the truth, the mission of Jesus? What would unify the church? I believe the answer is simple. It would take one enemy and one mission. The mission unites us. What did Jesus say after he suffered brutally on a cross and he looked up to heaven and said, "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." He shed his blood and gave his life. God raised him from the dead. And that's the last, and also take the last moment he's speaking to his disciples and he gives this divine assignment. And he says, "Here's your calling, here's your reason, here's your mission." And this is what Jesus said. He said, "Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit." That's what you do. That's who you are. That's your mission. That's what you stand for. That's the calling of our church, the ecclesia, the called out ones. One mission to help people know the life-giving love and grace of our Savior, Jesus. Sadly, what are we known for today? Well, when you ask just kind of a regular person on the street, like, what do you think about church? What is the church often known for? Well, some people would say, you know, the traditions of church. Other people might say the architectural structure of the historic buildings that are so beautiful. Some people would talk about the style, you know, that they're traditional. They have a full orchestra and a lovely church choir that sings a great gospel chorus. Or that they're contemporary. They got a really cool worship leader with skinny jeans and his hair product. That's pretty cool. But so often, you know what they would say is that they know us for? It's what we're for against. Oh, they don't like this, and they don't believe in that, and they don't go there. They don't associate with that type of person. Too often when people think about the church, they tend to think about what we're against. What if instead of being known for what we're against, what if as followers of Jesus we're known for what we are for love, grace, mercy, compassion, biblical justice, generosity? You see, the Bible gives us one example, and only one, of how the world will know that we are followers of Jesus. The reason they will know is by the way that we love one another. Jesus said it this way in John 13, verses 34 and 35. He said, "A new command I give to you, love one another as I have loved you. So you must love one another. By this everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you love one another." Wouldn't it be amazing if people would talk about Christians and talk about the churchgoers and talk about the body of Jesus and say things like, "Did you see how that person forgave? Did you see the grace that they displayed?" It's like mind-blowing the way that they treat one another and the way that they care about one another. They're always full of grace, always full of compassion. Those Christians, I may not completely agree with what they believe, but they always stand with the oppressed. They always give to those who are hurting. Oh, and that church on the street, they helped rebuild my house after a flood, or they visited me when I was in prison, and now I'm a changed person because of the love that they showed. They helped tutor my child. These Christians are the most compassionate, grace-filled, love, and generous people that I've ever seen. Wouldn't it be amazing if when the world thought about the church, they wouldn't think about what we were against, but they think about the godly, spirit-filled values that we're for? Paul said this, and it's important, in Romans chapter 15, verses 5, 6, and 7. He said, "May the God who gives you endurance and encouragement give you the same attitude of mind towards each other that Christ Jesus had, so that with," here it is again, "with one mind and one voice, you may glorify God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ." With one mind, with one voice, united in mission to share the love of Jesus. Now, how do we do that? Well, think about this. When I'm in my proper place, we are united. Whenever I move from my proper place, we are untied. Right now, as a nation of people, we are becoming untied, unraveled, divided, ripped apart. Why? Because so many of us are so arrogant thinking that our perspective is the only way. What I'd like to say to you is this, that Jesus is the only way our perspective of how we see the world can vary greatly, but we can be unified around the absolute truth that Jesus is the Son of God and he changes lives. But what does united look like? Like practically in everyday life, like you go to work, you're on social media, you're dealing with very complex people and so much pain and so much anger in the world. How do we unite in one voice? Well, Paul went on to say this. He said, "Accept one another just as Christ accepted you in order to bring praise to God." You want to glorify God. You want to accept one another. You want to love one another. In fact, the Greek word for accept one another is a very long and picturesque word that has depths of meaning. Essentially, this word, it means to open your arms and take a person to yourself. It's to embrace someone. To say, "I'm not even just going to let you pass by, but I'm going to pull you towards myself. I want you to feel my love. I want you to know that you belong, that you matter, that I care about you, that God loves you." It's to pull someone close. And then it's a picture of taking someone by the hand and walking together as companions. Like, "I accept you and I want to do life with you. I want to walk with you." Now, how do we do that with holding on to our beliefs? Because that's the part we get kind of prickly about, right? How do we accept people who are so different from us, with totally different perspectives, totally different backgrounds, and speak truth to them? Well, I think this is how we do it here. Paul said, "We accept one another just as Christ accepted you." Well, how did Jesus accept you? How did he accept me? Well, Scripture tells us that while we were still sinners, in other words, when we deserve nothing at all but judgment, Christ died for the unrighteous and the ungodly. He loved you that much that when you were not only imperfect, but you were unrighteous, you were sinning against a holy God, but he loved you. That's how we accept one another, the same way Christ accepted you. We don't excuse the sin or say it isn't a sin to help the person feel accepted. We love them and we accept them, the way Jesus did. And if you need a model for navigating a corrupt culture with maybe a religious/political government, that all sides, I mean, these people were all sides were confused and frustrated by with a culture where people were really, really hurting. Check out the Gospels. Read through the model that Christ laid out from Matthew 1:1 to John 21:25. What do we need? We have one enemy, and he is very real. He is attacking, and he's attacking now. And we have one mission, and it's indescribably important. I believe with all my heart that the world is sick and tired of hearing maybe just the Jesus talk. They don't want to hear us talk about him. They want to see him. So let's start loving. Let's not enter into a social media battle and just kind of blow up. We don't change anything that way. We change with our love. We have an enemy, Satan. His mission is to destroy. Our mission is to share the love of Jesus. How? Well, let's return to the Great Commission that Christ gave us. He said, "Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you." So let's kind of break this down. Therefore, go. Now listen, I know we feel very stuck by COVID, and I get that, but go on your phones, go on your social media, go through letter writing, go. We cannot make disciples huddled up on our own. Make disciples of all nations. Jesus was talking about geographical nations, but also simply talking about, he was talking about also race. Scripture time and time again shows us that all nations, all peoples are equal in God's eyes. The goal of this unification is a unification in Christ. The equality that we have is through our Savior. Apart from him, the world is broken. It says, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Who do you know that has not accepted Jesus? Pray for them daily. Love them. Ask them if they would accept Jesus. You know that there are people in your life that need him. Absolutely. So go. Work up the courage to do that. Teaching them to obey everything that I have commanded you. We cannot do this unless we know the scriptures. There are so many things that we say as Christians that aren't even in the Bible. They're like little proverbs that we've created. And the sentiment may be valid or it may not, but we won't know unless we know God's word. We live in a world that is divided because there has been a cultural rejection of absolute truth. We've accepted that whatever feels right must be so, and that your truth is as valid as my truth. But if our truths contradict one another, what then? Well, in order to truly accept one another, in the most biblical sense of the word, not the political sense, we must know our mission and know our enemy. We have to recognize that there is a real spiritual warfare, and the sides are not left versus right. It's the kingdom of God versus the kingdom of darkness. We unify around the truth and the power of Jesus. So what does Jesus do? Well, racism is a problem, right? And the love of Jesus, it overcomes hatred, prejudice, and racism. But what about addictions? The power of Jesus breaks the chains of addiction. The grace of Jesus helps you forgive and heal broken relationships. What can Jesus do? Jesus is going to help someone be released from the bondage of materialism and be set free from debt. Jesus can heal. He can protect you from the attacks of the devil. He can free you from the prison of comparison. He can calm your anxieties. He can relieve your stress. He can give you the supernatural peace that goes beyond your human ability to understand. Who is Jesus? He is the Son of God who never sinned, who loved you so much that he gave his life on a cross for you, so that you could be forgiven, so you could be healed, so you could be free. He did it when we didn't deserve it. We're to love others, even though their behavior may not feel deserving. We love as he loved us. We are part of the body of Christ, the family of God, the church. We don't go to church. We are the church, and we believe that the local church is the hope of the world. And we can infinitely do more together than we can apart. Who are we? We're followers of Jesus. They're not going to know us just by how we vote or what we post or what we're for or against. But what we're going to do is they're going to know us by how we love one another. I beg you, I urge you, for the one who gave all for us. Can we get this right? Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your mind, and all your soul and your strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. That's our assignment, to go into this world and love. We have an enemy who hates God and hates God's people and is trying to divide. We have one enemy. We have one mission. And we recognize the enemy is attacking. But greater is he who is in us than he is who is in the world. We can overcome with the same spirit that raised Christ from the dead. That spirit dwells within you. So let's do it. When they look at us, when they talk about us, I pray that they talk about our love and be overwhelmed by grace, the compassion, the mercy, the love, that they will know that we're followers of Jesus by the way that we love one another. And I'll end on this quote from C.S. Lewis, from his book, A Mere Christianity. C.S. Lewis wrote this: "Do not waste your time bothering whether you love your neighbor. Act as if you did. As soon as we do this, we find one of the great secrets. When we are behaving as if you love someone, you will presently come to love him. If you injure someone you dislike, you will find yourself disliking him more. If you do him a good turn, you will find yourself disliking him less. Go into the world and share the gospel to all who will hear, and love like Jesus loves you." Will you pray with me? Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you so much for this day. Lord, we know that we have one enemy, and that he is trying to attack us, divide us. But Lord, we know who wins. We know where our feet are planted, and it's on you. You are our foundation. And Lord, we pray that you will equip this church to be a light in our community. May we stand for love rather than hate. Lord, that may we be able to share the wonderful love and grace that you have given us and be able to do that in our communities. God, we don't deserve your love and grace, but you give it to us. So let us live like it. Let us give this free gift to everyone, Lord, to share it to our coworkers, our neighbors, our family, Lord, because it is not something that we keep to ourselves, but something to be shared amongst the whole world. Equip us to do that. Lord, if we're afraid, I pray that we may be bold, that you may give us the boldness to be able to share. Lord, if we have the inkling of doing wrong, Lord, I pray that we lean on you, we resist that temptation, and we lean on you for guidance and for help, God, because you are our rock and our refuge. We love you. It's your name I pray. Amen.
We gather in Jesus' name. His love is burning in our hearts like living flame. For through the loving Son, the Father makes us one. Come take the bread, come drink the cup, come share the Lord. He joins us here, he breaks the bread. The Lord who breaks the cup is risen from the dead. The one we love the most is now our gracious host. Come take the bread, come drink the cup, come share the Lord. No one is a stranger here. Everyone belongs. Finding our forgiveness here, we in turn forgive all wrongs. We are we anticipate the feast for which we wait. Come take the cup, come drink the cup, come share the Lord.
Each Sunday, we set aside time to remember Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection in the way he asked us to. All who name Jesus as Lord are invited to share in this communion with us, with the bread and the cup, or even by simply taking a moment now to reflect, remember, and give thanks for Jesus' indescribable gift of love and life.
It matters why we do this. On the night he was betrayed, Jesus broke bread. He gave it to his disciples. Take and eat. This is my body. He took a cup. Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the covenant. It is poured out for many, for the forgiveness of sins. It matters how we do this. Let each of us look at our lives. Let us recognize our sin. Let us see the grace of God in the body and blood of Christ, broken for us, poured out for our forgiveness. It matters that we do this. Let us eat the bread. Drink from the cup. Remember the Lord's death in our place on the cross, looking for his return. Amen.
That we may praise, may praise the name of
Thank you for sharing this time with us today. If you are subscribed to our weekly e-news, you received some preliminary information regarding our plans to regather. No set date yet, but some details about what to expect when we do resume in-person services. Continue watching for updates. Meanwhile, plan to join us online again next Sunday, July 5th. We continue to offer online giving as a way to remain faithful in financial stewardship. And our Care Hub is always available for you to share concerns for prayer. We will have our Zoom fellowship time at 11:30 a.m. and the Zoom prayer meeting at noon. Ellie Hamilton is your email contact to receive the login details. And, of course, there are online events for kid men and middle and high school students. And speaking of events, Bryce and Maverin have some very exciting news to share.
A recipe for VBS. Crafts. Let's see what we've got here. Fun. Mm-hmm. Bible stories. Games. Friends. Oh, yeah. There we go. COVID-19.
I bet you guys didn't think we would have VBS this year, thanks to COVID-19. But that's just simply not true. VBS will be back. It'll just be in your backyard. You'll get a lot of information about it in the coming weeks. But the important thing is VBS is back, and it starts in just 3 days.
What? I thought you said they'd be getting more information in the coming weeks.
Yeah.
But you said it starts in 3 days.
Yeah.
Okay.
No, okay, so here's the deal. VBS will be officially rolling out in August. You're going to get information in the coming weeks through email, YouTube announcements like these, and I need everybody to mark your calendars for our July 12th VBS meeting. The sign-up is going to be linked down in the comments below. It'll be on our Facebook page, and it'll be sent out in the emails.
Okay, so how is VBS starting in 3 days?
VBS starts in 3 days because we are going to start collecting gift cards as a part of our mission this year for VBS. You're going to get more information about it, but the important thing is when you go to pick up your weekly groceries, pick up a gift card from a grocery store, Uber Eats, Grubhub, any restaurants, anything like that where we can give a meal or some groceries to a family in need. And again, you're going to get a lot more information about it.
Okay, well, so how so?
Well, you mean like how is it going to be used?
Yeah.
Well, like I said, you guys will get a lot more information about it. I promise as time comes through, I'm sure you're going to have more questions. You can always email me, events@manorwoods.com. But the important thing for today is three things. One, VBS is going to be back, and it's going to be in your backyard. So number two, please sign up for the VBS information meeting on July 12th, and you'll get all the information there. Number three, please start picking up those gift cards and dropping them off at the church or mailing them in if you're not going out right now. So that's it.
All right. Well, be on the lookout for emails and more information on our Facebook and YouTube pages coming your way.
Thanks, everyone.
Thanks, guys.
Thank you, Coopers. Be watching for those updates and be ready to participate. It's just one more way we can stay on mission. And with that mission in mind, let's conclude now with this charge from the first letter to the Corinthians. Therefore, my beloved brothers, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that in the Lord your labor is not in vain.